In this video, I'm going to further explore the formula language from Inforiver, and this time I'm going to look at inserting columns. So here I am online again, powerbi.com, and I'm going into edit mode, and I have my Inforiver custom visual here. What I'm about to show you is available in Pro and Premium and above. Now, first of all, we'll take a look at the setup. I have product category and subcategory in the rows section, and I have the total sales measure coming from the sales table. And I can jump over to the insert menu, and there's this option to insert a formula. Now, before I do that, there are a number of inbuilt formulas which you can use. These are literally out of the box. And if we take, for example, this one here, contribution to parent, I can click on that, create that as a column. And you can see that this is actually quite a common use case where I want to work out, say at the subcategory level, that these three items, what percentage are they of the parent? Or in other words, what percentage are they of bikes? And then when I get to the category level, I'd like to know what percentage of these of all sales. And so this is a pretty standard use case, and we do have an inbuilt quick formula to do that. But I'm trying to show you the formula language and how you can use that in columns. And so I'm going to show you how you could write this particular column using the formula language. So I'm going to come up and insert a formula, and I'll call this percentage of parent. And let me just explore a few things with you before I get in and write the final formula. So you'll notice that there's some references here. So let's just take a few of those and have a look what happens. So if I select subcategory and click create, as the name suggests, it's actually giving me the value that is the subcategory. So if I come in and try to do category, as you might expect, it's giving me the category that each row belongs to. So if you're in the DAX language, this would be equivalent to selected value. All right, so let me delete the category, and this time I'll select total sales, and we'll have a look at what this gives us. And so the total sales formula just gives me the total sales from the total sales column, and the filtering that's applied at the category or the subcategory level is applied. So this is just a way of accessing the value in the cell next to it. Now, as I'm sure you can understand, in order to be able to do a percentage of parent, when I'm at the subcategory level, I'm going to need to get access to this total which belongs to the category. And when I'm at the category level, I'm going to need to get access to the total that is for the total of all sales. And so to do that, there is a function, and I can come over here to functions, or I can just type these in. So there's a function called row. So if I just type in row, you'll see that this gives me an error. So this one can't be used on its own, but what you can use row for is to refer to the parent. So I typed in row, hit the dot, and then tab for parent, and if I update, still gives an error, but what I can do is I can say total sales. So row.parent.totalSales. And when I do that, I literally get access to the next level up in the hierarchy, the total sales figure. Now, of course, if I want to work out the percentage of parent, then I just need to put a space in here, and I need to take the total sales from this row and divide it by the parent. And I'll click update. Now, before I go ahead and change this to percentage, notice that I've got an NA here, and that makes sense because if we're at the total level, there is no parent, and therefore that returns NA. So what I really need to do is handle that. Now, using similar functions that you would expect in Excel, if I just put a space and I'll type in if, I have two options. There's an if function and there's also an if NA function. So in this case, I'll take the if NA function and I'll just use my intuition here. If the formula returns NA, then what do I want it to return? I actually want it to return 1 in this case. So I'll click update. And so now we're getting the 1. So I can now close this down and come up to the formatting and apply percentage formatting, and that's given me the numbers that I want. Now, if at any time I want to remove any of these columns that I've added, I can just come up and delete them here. So I think I'll delete this percent contribution, the automatic one, and I'll leave the one that I created myself. All right, so now I'm going to add another page and I'll add another InfoRiver visual. And this time I'm going to bring product subcategory into the visual. And I'd like to analyze the quantity of products that have been sold. So first of all, I'll move this into full screen mode so that we can see the menu. And then I'll come in here and I'll change the formatting. So I'll get rid of the decimal place. Also with this header, even though this is an implicit measure coming from Power BI, I can actually come in here and I can just call this, say, total quantity. All right, so now I've got the total quantity or the number of items that have been sold for each subcategory. Now, the use case I'd like to demonstrate now, to demonstrate another calculated column, is I would like to understand for each of these accessories, so jerseys and gloves and shorts, for every 100 bikes that I sell, how many shorts am I selling? For every 100 bikes that I sell, how many helmets am I selling? This is a very good industry metric to make sure that you're selling the maximum number of accessories as you could sell. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to first of all do a calculated row. So I'm going to perhaps move my bikes into one location. So let me bring up mountain bikes, touring bikes, and road bikes, and I'll bring them all up the top. And I'll use the technique that I covered in inserting rows to insert a calculated row, and this can just be total bikes. Now, of course, I could do this with a category, but because of the way I want this visual to look, I'm choosing just to create my own calculated row. And so the total bikes will be touring bikes plus road bikes plus mountain bikes. And I don't want to include it in the total, and I'll just click create. Okay, now a couple of things to make this look a little bit nicer. I'll click on the three bike products. I'll just indent these a little bit, and I'll also come in here and apply some formatting like I did in the insert row videos. So I've created some visual interest here to identify that the bikes are something different to the other products. I might even add a static row here. So I'll insert a static row and I'll just call this accessories. And that way I can actually use effectively a blank row just to separate the data from the top of my visual and the bottom of my visual. So the next thing I want to do is insert a column and calculate for every 100 bikes that I'm selling, how many accessories am I selling? So I'll come up and insert a formula that will insert a column by default. And this will be accessories per 100 bikes. And the formula, I'll need to first of all access the total quantity. And I need to divide that total quantity by this number here. And the total quantity, when I type it like this, is the relative reference, if you like. So the total quantity is going to grab the quantity for this particular row. But if I need to do a division against this number here, I can either refer to it using the formula language, or it's probably easier just to click in the cell. And that will select that one cell for me. And so now I've got total quantity divided by the total bikes, and I'll click create. And what I need to do is come back here and times it by 100 because this is per 100 bikes. And so now what this formula is showing me is that for every 100 bikes that we sell 113 tires and tubes, 52 bottles and cages, and so on. Now just to extend this visual a little bit further, it probably doesn't make sense to have these numbers here. And what I can do is I can highlight those numbers and come up to the home tab and just hide them. I don't actually need to see those numbers in this particular visual, so I'll just hide those out of sight. Okay, so I've jumped over to a P&L example, and I'd like to show you how you can insert a formula to calculate the percentage of net sales revenue. So this is a very common requirement. So what I'll do is I'll insert a new column in this table. So I'll come up to Insert Formula, And I can come in here and click on the cell, same as before. I can refer to the amount, which will be the relative reference for the cell. So if I'm at this cell here, the amount will refer to 50.06, that's the amount, and divided by, and this time I want to always divide by the net sales revenue. So I just click in this cell here, and I'll call this percent of net sales revenue, and I'll click create, and come over here, apply some formatting, so come up to home, we'll do percentage formatting, and maybe one decimal place. Okay, so now that I've got that number in here, as before, if I don't want to see these numbers up here, I can hide them, or maybe I'll just hide that top number. If I wanted to hide them all, I could come in and multi-select these and hide them. But for now, I'll leave those in there because gross sales are 105% of net sales revenue. And you can see as we go down cost of sales, gross margin, etc., as a percentage of net sales revenue. Now, just before I move away from this P&L example, I'd like to show you a very nice feature, which is called blending. And what it allows you to do is to take two columns and basically create one column from the two columns. So I've actually switched over to the premium version of Inforiver here. And if I come to the Insert tab, you'll now note that there's a blend button. So I'm going to multi-select these two columns. And instead of having this percentage of net sales revenue sort of out to the right, I'm going to blend those two columns into one. Notice that it creates effectively a new measure or a new column. I'm going to call this amount because I still like the name amount. And I'll say and percentage of NSR. And I'm using two measures, the amount measure and the percentage of NSR. You do have a choice of vertical or horizontal blending, but the vertical blending is the one that gives you some space saving. So I'll go ahead and do that. And once I've done that, I can actually come up and hide these other columns. So I don't need to see the amount anymore, and I don't need to see the percentage of net sales revenue. I can just keep that one blended column. And I can expand that out, and it looks pretty nice and compact. Now, the other interesting thing, if I just bring back this percent of net sales revenue, is that it's not only the numbers and the formatting that comes across, but it's also the entire set of formatting. So if I was to come up and change the font color, say, to a light blue, you'll notice that the formatting comes across, which makes this whole thing a lot easier to read and consume. Now, going back to this earlier version of the P&L, what I'll do now is I'll come up and I'll hide this percentage of net sales revenue column for the time being. So I've already done the formula. I don't want to delete it, but for this next example, I don't want to use it. And I'm going to go up to the calendar table and bring the calendar year and add it as a column. Now, once I have an item on a column, like is shown here, if I now go to insert a formula, I get two options. I get an option to put a visual measure, which means the formula will be nested within each column, or I can switch to a visual column, which has the effect of adding a new column at this calendar year level, which is the current case. And so I could do something like taking the average of the last 2 years. So with that in mind, I could come in here and say take the 2007 sales number and add to that the 2008 number, and then of course divide by 2. And once I've done that, I need to give it a good name, so I'll just call it 2007/8 average. And I'll click create. Now also notice that when I do this, by default I get given a label at the top here because I've actually inserted a new item effectively at the column level, so it has to put some value here. But this is completely editable. I can come in here and just say average, or you know, something like 2 year average, or indeed if I don't want to see it at all, I can just come up and hide it as I've shown in other cases. Now, so far, for every column that I've added using the Inforiver formula language, I've used the formula feature. So let me show you what I mean. If I go insert formula here, I could come in here and take the total quantity and divide it by the total at the grand total level, click create, and notice that I've left the rogue aggregation type as being a formula, and therefore whatever the formula is that I write up here is what gets applied throughout the entire column. But that's not the way it has to be. So let me get rid of this one and I'll show you the alternative, which is using one of the other aggregation types. Right, so now I'll add a new column. So insert a formula, and this will be what I'll call bottom up. And my formula this time, instead of actually using one of the references from within the visual, I'm just going to say 1K. So basically I'm going to assign 1000, and this time I'll use the sum aggregation type. So once I create this new formula, you'll notice that it adds 1000 at each of the children level within the visual, and then because I've got my aggregation type set to sum, those numbers add up to the accessories level and then up to the total level. Now, before I move off this, let me just show you the different types of aggregations that you can use. So the main one would be sum, where you're adding individual numbers and then adding them up to a total and a subtotal. But you can also use average. Now, in the case of the example I have here, average is, of course, going to give me 1000 because all of these data points are the same. But if I close this down, and I can now come in and actually change individual data points, so I can put, say, 500 into this one and 2000 into this one and so on, and you can see how the subtotals and totals now are actually averaging the individual data points rather than summing those points. So that can be changed at any time. You can come back in here. I could switch to the minimum. If I update that, it'll obviously bring the minimum number and so on. So these are pretty standard Excel style aggregation types that you can use depending on what it is that you're trying to do. But let me just reset this back to what I had before. So I'm going to update that, and then I'll just reset these two data points here. So you can click on individual data points and just hit the reset. Okay, so now that I've done that, I can go ahead and start changing these numbers and use the sum aggregation to add up for total and subtotal. So I can put 5K, I can just basically type in any individual number that I want. So cleaners might be 2K, and if I just want to do something like this, could be 500. So you can type numbers like this, and each time you make a change, the numbers roll up because I set the aggregation type to be sum. Now, another interesting feature here is if I take one of these nodes, in this case it's the bikes, and I double click on this node, notice that it goes into edit mode, and then using this menu here, I can say by default, this will give me the sum of the children. That's the way it's designed to work. But I can actually come in now and edit this formula and just delete what's in there and change this node so that it's no longer the addition of all three children, but it's now just the addition of two children. So if I double click in here, you'll see that it's actually now only referring to two of the three children. Now, of course, you need to be very careful if you're doing this, that it's not inconsistent in communication to the people that are reading your reports, but I'm just showing you the capabilities that are possible. And if I wanted to reset this cell, I can just come up here and click the reset button, and that will go back to the standard behavior.